it's Friday, May 20 here in Manila. I'm Mike Navalio giving you the head start for the day. Our guests for today's Hot Copy. First, we have the lawyer of presumptive President Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos as we talk about the petition to hold the canvassing of votes for the country's highest post. Later, we also have former UP Dean College of Law, former UP College of Law Dean Pacifico Agabin as we talk about the possible scenarios on the petition. First, the headlines. Today's big stories: the Philippines' May 9 polls failed to meet the criteria for free and fair elections, according to a group of international observers. Senate President Vicente Soto III warns of a constitutional crisis should the High Court suspend Congress's canvassing of votes for the country's top two polls. And more European countries report cases of monkeypox. The International Coalition for Human Rights in the Philippines says the country's May 9 polls failed to meet the criteria for free and fair elections. The ICHRP, along with other groups that made up the International Observer Mission, cited incidents of political killings, large-scale red tagging, and various forms of vote buying throughout the election campaign season until the day ballots were cast. The IOM said their local partner, Contradaya, received around 9,000 election complaints, nearly half of which have already been verified. The group also blasted the vote counting machine glitches, which they say rocked the confidence of the public on the outcome of the elections.
The last Philippine election was marred by widespread irregularities and violence, which undermined the democratic process. The elections took place in the most repressive context since the time of dictator Marcos.
It is actually difficult for voters to be confident in election proceedings marred by machine errors and breakdowns, as these cast doubt on the capacity of the machine to count their votes.
But Malacanang just brushed off these criticisms, insisting the elections were clean and fair. Acting presidential spokesperson Martin Andanar says they will leave it to the Philippine Election Commission to disprove the allegations. The Philippine Supreme Court cannot stop the canvassing of votes for president and vice president. That's the assertion of the camp of leading presidential bed Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. Marcos's counsel Estelito Mendoza said, according to constitutional provisions, the counting of votes is mandatory and the highest court in the land does not have the jurisdiction to prevent it. Marcos's camp, as well as the Election Commission and Congress, were asked by the Supreme Court to comment within 15 days on a petition for certiorari filed by civic leaders. The group sought to overturn the ruling of the poll body, which junked their plea to cancel Marcos's certificate of candidacy. They also wanted the High Court to issue a temporary restraining order to stop Congress from canvassing the votes for Marcos. Senate President Vicente Soto III earlier warned of a constitutional crisis should the group's petition prosper in the High Court. Senate Minority Leader Franklin Drelon, for his part, believes that's unlikely to happen. Despite moves to suspend the canvassing of votes for the president and vice president, Congress is now making final preparations for the scheduled tallying on Monday. Zandro Ochona reports.
Where the ballot boxes containing the ERs will be stored.
For the first time in 35 years, the plenary hall of the House of Representatives was renovated in time for the canvassing on Monday for the presidential and vice presidential votes. Security around the Batasang Pambansa has been tightened. Strict health protocols are being observed. House Secretary General Mark Mendoza said it's all systems go for Tuesday's canvassing.
Ready na tayo, ready na yung house ano, sa canvassing next week. The meeting yesterday naman was a debriefing lang yung team sa mga members natin, no? Members ng canvassing committee ng part ng House.
7 members from each Houses of Congress will compose the Senate and the House of Representatives contingent to the canvassing, with equal number of alternates if any of the members will miss the joint session. Since the election returns and certificates of canvass are digital, canvassing is expected to be quick.
99.88% yata nung validation and yung pag-check nila, comparing it with the digital transmissions were actually accurate, no? So I think this election has been very transparent. Technology has helped us a lot, and participation of the people has been an all-time high. So we will give due course naman with what the people wanted, who they voted for.
Members also give the assurance all sides will be heard during the canvassing.
I think well represented naman ang lahat-lahat. If we have issues, I think it's more on the returns, then that will be entertained. Pero mag issues kasi baka isama eh, no? Pero I think we will stick to the canvassing lang.
Senate Majority Leader Juan Miguel Zubiri assures there will be a new Senate leader by June 30 to prevent instability and a constitutional crisis if the canvassing is stopped. The Supreme Court en banc is currently on recess and will resume on June 14. On Thursday, the SC has asked the Marcoses camp, COMELEC, Senate, and the House of Representatives to comment on the petition to cancel Marcoses COC. COMELEC says they will comply and will file their comment accordingly. The lawyer for the civic leaders who filed the petition hope the High Court will resolve the issue expeditiously since it involves public interest. The canvassing is expected to be over in 3 days and the new president and vice president proclaimed by May 27. Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
Joining us now in Hot Copy is the lawyer of Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., Attorney Estelito Mendoza. Good morning, Attorney Mendoza. Welcome to Head Start.
Good morning to you also.
Attorney Mendoza, this is Mike Navalio. I want to ask you, you're saying that the Supreme Court does not have jurisdiction to stop the canvassing and proclamation of winners in this year's polls, particularly on the presidential and vice presidential race.
Yes, the Supreme Court has no jurisdiction to stop the canvassing and the proclamation of the newly elected president because the terms of the Constitution are explicit and clear. The Constitution provides that the incumbent president shall end 6 years after his assumption of office, that is President Duterte, his term of office shall end 6 years. That is provided in the Constitution. And there is no way of stopping it. And President Duterte has explicitly also acknowledged that he will abide by the Constitution. On the other hand, the term of the new president is explicitly also provided that it shall start on the 30th day of June following the election.
Attorney Mendoza, the dates being cited in the Constitution are June 30, 12 noon. Is there not enough time between today and June 30 for the Supreme Court to step in, perhaps stop the canvassing first and resolve the issue of disqualification or the cancellation of COC? Because just for the benefit of our viewers, Attorney Mendoza is citing Section 4 of Article 7 of the Constitution.
The Supreme Court can step in because the terms of the Constitution are explicit and clear. They are to be followed as provided in the Constitution in text and in language.
But Attorney Mendoza, the date when the new president takes office is on June 30. So we still have more than a month. Is there not time for the Supreme Court to go over the disqualification or cancellation of COC cases before proceeding to the proclamation? Is there not room for that in the language and the text of the Constitution?
The Senate and the Congress, or the same Congress, have no jurisdiction to determine the question raised in the petition for review on the decision of the COMELEC as to the validity of the certificate of candidacy. That is a matter vested in the COMELEC, and there is no provision whereby the Supreme Court can intervene on that issue at this point in time. Perhaps that will have to come when the after the proclamation, and the petitioners will then have to decide whether to abide and stick by their petition as filed by the Supreme Court, or whether the scenario has changed, and that therefore what they should be filing is an election protest before the Supreme Court, either a quo warranto or an ordinary election protest.
Attorney Mendoza, you're referring to quo warranto to question the qualifications of whoever will be proclaimed as president. You also mentioned the election protest. Can the election protest be used to unseat, for example, in the event that there's such a decision, to unseat a sitting president, which is an impeachable officer who can only be removed through impeachment or quo warranto?
Well, there is no. We have an electoral presidential tribunal which is vested with that jurisdiction to determine the qualifications of the incoming president. There is a presidential electoral tribunal.
What will happen, Attorney Mendoza, to the pending petition before the Supreme Court, the one seeking to overturn the COMELEC decision on the disqualification cases and cancellation of COC cases before the COMELEC? What will happen to that once there is a proclamation? Will that continue, or is there a need to shift to an election protest?
This will all happen only after the new president shall have assumed office.
So what's the scenario, Attorney Mendoza, when that happens? Is there a need to file a new case, or will the Supreme Court cases continue even after proclamation?
Well, that will be depend on the petitioners and what they feel is more appropriate.
Just to be clear, Attorney Mendoza, you're saying that the Supreme Court cannot stop the canvassing and proclamation. Are you also making the argument that the Supreme Court has no jurisdiction to look into how COMELEC resolved the cases before it?
I have filed with the Supreme Court a pleading against the Supreme Court issuing a temporary restraining order to stop this canvassing of votes by the Congress and the proclamation of the winning candidate. And I believe the Supreme Court has not only given due course, but has granted that argument by not issuing a temporary restraining order.
Attorney, so that's your position, Attorney Mendoza. The when was your pleading filed? It was filed yesterday, but at what time? Was it before the release of the Supreme Court's order? And could they have taken that into account when they ordered the respondents to comment?
Well, there is no order. Yes, it was filed before. It was filed. I think,
Let's give time, Attorney Mendoza, to look over the documents. Yeah. All right. So if it was filed at 2 p.m. yesterday, what's your reaction to the fact that the Supreme Court did not issue a TRO and instead gave the respondents, COMELEC, Mr. Marcos, Senate, the House of Representatives, 15 days to comment?
That is 15 days to comment on the petition, but not on the TRO, because the TRO has already been denied.
There was no such ruling yet on the press release issued by the Supreme Court, Attorney Mendoza. If I can just go over the press briefer, it includes a comment on the prayer for a temporary restraining order, Attorney Mendoza. So both the petition and the prayer for the TRO, the respondents are being asked to comment.
Well, the Supreme Court issued a denial of the TRO only recently and very promptly when it had to do so after we filed a manifestation opposing the issuance of a TRO.
Attorney Mendoza, you're saying that the TRO, the prayer for TRO, has now been denied by the Supreme Court? We have yet to see a ruling on that. What's the basis, Attorney Mendoza? Are you referring to the press briefer issued yesterday?
That is a ruling denying the TRO. That is explicitly stated in the Supreme Court resolution that the Supreme Court, that the TRO is denied.
Let me read to you the resolution, Attorney Mendoza. Whereas, considering the allegations contained, the issues raised, and the arguments adduced in the petition, without necessarily giving due course thereto, it is necessary and proper to require the respondents to comment on the petition and prayer for temporary restraining order within a period of 15 days from notice hereof. This is based on the press briefer yesterday. Are you referring to another document? Is there a subsequent a development after this press briefer denying the prayer for TRO?
Well, I don't know. I believe the Supreme Court resolution states also that the deny prayer for a TRO is denied.
I'm not seeing that in the press briefer. But assuming, Attorney Mendoza, that what you're saying is indeed what will happen, that the prayer for TRO is denied. Do you consider this a victory for your client? Attorney Mendoza, is this a victory if the TRO is not granted? In effect, Mong Marcos will be proclaimed.
Victory, not only for my client, but for the Filipino people to know that they will have a new president as mandated by their votes cast in the last election by an overwhelming majority. You must not overlook the majority which BBM obtained in the last elections.
Mm-hmm. Attorney Mendoza, the question though is, what happens assuming that there is already a proclamation, right? Will you be asking for the dismissal of these pending cases before the Supreme Court?
Well, a comment is required to be filed on the petition, and therefore in the comment, you may expect that we will be asking for the dismissal of the petition. You must remember that this issue of disqualification was ruled upon by COMELEC division, and that later on it was ruled upon by the COMELEC and Bank. So you have already two rulings affirming the qualification of BBM.
Attorney Mendoza, do you think that these rulings of the COMELEC can be challenged through a petition for certiorari before the Supreme Court? Is there grave abuse of discretion on the part of COMELEC if what the petitioners are asking is to essentially overturn their ruling? So they're asking the Supreme Court for a different appreciation of the facts and the arguments. Can that be challenged through a certiorari, which claims to question the grave abuse of discretion of a government agency?
Well, that is the point in their petition for review, they will no doubt challenge the resolutions of the COMELEC and bank. That is what is now before the Supreme Court, the resolution of the COMELEC and bank, no longer the resolutions of the COMELEC divisions.
Yes. Does the Supreme Court have jurisdiction to entertain that petition for certiorari of the COMELEC resolutions?
It has jurisdiction to entertain the certiorari petition, but it had no jurisdiction to issue a temporary restraining order to stop the canvassing of the votes and the proclamation of the winning candidate. That means BBM. The election was mandated by the majority, overwhelming majority he obtained in the last election, cannot be restrained or stopped by the Supreme Court.
Attorney Mendoza, what is the danger if the Supreme Court decides to stop the canvassing and the proclamation? Will it lead to a constitutional crisis, as one of the lawmakers is suggesting?
That is not allowed by the Constitution, because the Constitution very prudently provide for explicit dates when the canvassing shall take place. It provides explicitly within what time the Senate President shall open the certificates of canvass received from every province and chartered city.
Not later than 30 days from the elections, right, Attorney Mendoza? So that period for opening the certificates of canvass, not later than 30 days from May 9.
The danger is that we will have a situation where we have no precedent. President Duterte's term explicitly ended on June, 6 years after his election.
Attorney Mendoza, when we talk about these terms, this period set in the Constitution, how are we able to determine that these are mandatory? Is it enough to rely on the language, the use of the word shall in these provisions? Or are there any indications, are there any cases saying that Congress should canvass the votes at this particular period?
As a matter of constitutional interpretation, you can determine whether the terms are mandatory or directory by its language and context. You must consider not only the language, which is very explicit, but also the context in which those terms are utilized.
Now, Attorney Mendoza, let's talk about the general petition now pending before the Supreme Court. In your reading of the Supreme Court, how likely is it that the Supreme Court, as a non-elected body, will defer to the vote of the 31 million Filipinos in favor of Bongbong Marcos? Of course, the other camp is saying the number of votes is not determinative of the outcome. If he is disqualified from taking office, he should be disqualified.
It's not only likely, it is mandated to respect the votes cast by the Filipino people. And in this case, the overwhelming majority of BBM.
Go ahead, Attorney Mendoza.
Well, as I said, the Constitution is very explicit on what it has to do after an election. It has provisions step by step when the Senate President, it says, the returns of every election for President and Vice President duly certified by the Board of Canvassers of its province or city shall be transmitted to Congress, directed to the President of the Senate. Upon receipt of the certificates of canvass, the President of the Senate shall, and this is clear, not later than 30 days after the day of the election, open all the certificates in the presence of the Senate and the House of Representatives in joint public session, and the Congress, upon determination of the authenticity and due execution thereof in the manner provided by law, canvass the verse. The person having the highest number of votes shall be proclaimed elected. So this is language of the Constitution. There is no departing from it. It is clear, and by its language, as I said, it is mandatory in character. The framers of the Constitution dealt with this step by step, even providing for the time when the Senate President shall make a report to Congress for the canvassing of the votes.
Mm-hmm. Attorney Mendoza, it says not later than 30 days. So it's not a definite day, or it's not a definite day like, for example, May 9. Is there not room for the Supreme Court to say, let's halt it for a while, resolve the disqualification case or cancellation of COCA case within that 30-day period, assuming they can do it within 30 days?
No, the Supreme Court, the President of the Senate, will have to follow the time provided in the Constitution. Otherwise, they will be in breach of the Constitution itself. As I said, the framers of the Constitution took the necessary steps to assure that there will be no void in the presidency of the country after an election.
Mm-hmm. All right, Attorney Mendoza, based on your arguments, it seems that the proclamation will push through. BBM will most likely, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos will most likely be proclaimed. But assuming that the Supreme Court decides on the pending disqualification or cancellation of COC cases, and they decide to disqualify Mr. Marcos, who will be likely to succeed the president? I mean, is this an issue of succession, the vice president or the second placer? After proclamation.
That is a long time coming, if ever, and it will not come in our view. There is no basis for disqualifying BBM.
Mm-hmm. All right. So you're confident, Attorney Mendoza, that will never happen?
That question you raise is a long-standing question in the legal field. What happens in case a elected president, elected official is disqualified?
And that has never been resolved, Attorney Mendoza.
I would rather deal with that at this time. That is a very sensitive and delicate issue. And there are several decisions of the Supreme Court going either way.
Mm-hmm. And you don't see any issues with the fact that the Supreme Court has asked the respondents to comment to that particular petition against Bongbong Marcos. Can this not be considered also a win for the petitioners, that the fact that the Supreme Court acted?
Well, actually, the requirement to comment is practically a matter which generally only happens is just to comment on the petition. You must remember, it's just to comment. It is not to answer the petition. There is a difference. If the Supreme Court requires the respondents to answer That means it has found merit in the petition. But what it required is just for the respondents to comment to the petition, not to answer the petition.
Mm-hmm. All right. On that note, Attorney Mendoza, I understand we only have 30 minutes of your time today. Thank you so much for joining us this morning and for shedding light on some of the issues concerning your client, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr.
You are most welcome.
All right. We hope to have you again on ANC. Thank you, Attorney Mendoza.
Anytime.
All right. And we are taking a quick break. Head Start will be right back. To Head Start. Newly proclaimed senators in the Philippines share their legislative plans and priorities more than a month before the country's 19th Congress convenes. Sharian Torres reports.
It took a Senate proclamation for estranged brothers, Senators-elect Jinggoy Estrada and JV Ejercito, to share the same stage. Observers saw this as an act of reconciliation, but after the event, it appears the show of unity is simply just that. The senators-elect vow to observe critical collaboration with each other but still uphold their independence to call out government's missteps. Lone opposition Senator Risa Ontiveros confirms Senator Aquilino Coco Pimentel will be part of the new minority group.
If Sen Coco is interested to lead it, I'm very open to supporting him. Basta ang number one priority ko ngayon ay yung pagbubuo ng minorya. And bahagi ng pagbubuo ng minorya, yung division of labor namin, sinong gagawa ng anong trabaho. Basta't ang pinaka-importante, maging tunay kami, makapag-check and balance at fiscalize, at epektibo maging sa legislation tulad ng nagagawa namin these past 6 years.
Ontiveros adds, she continues to reach out to other senators. Senator-elect Alan Peter Cayetano, who recently took a swipe at senators aspiring to lead the chamber, speaks out on talks he will be joining the minority bloc and even how he will act under a Marcos presidency. During the 2016 vice presidential race, Cayetano lambasted then-Senator Marcos Jr. over his family's ill-gotten wealth.
There are issues regarding the Marcos family that will remain. And it's up to them to answer that. It's up to you, sa media, to hound them on that. It's out to the people to go to them and hold them accountable. Pero iba yon na ngayon siya na-elect, if the Senate, most of them, feel like they will have a Senate that will be part of this administration in a way that they feel that they should not fiscalize, then I cannot be part of that. Same thing sa minority. Kung meron tayong minority na lahat na lang nang gawin eh magkri-criticize, hindi rin makakatulong yon.
For Senator-elect Robin Padilla, the newbie lawmaker says he will no longer do movies and will just concentrate on his legislative work. Senator-elect Rafi Tulfo, for his part, wants to craft laws for workers and lead the Senate committees on labor, civil service, and migrant workers. The newbie senator also shares what he's looking for in the next Senate president.
Yung senador na makapag-deliver yung character and very important to me. Yung senador na wala masyadong business interest na poprotektahan. I'll be joining the majority. Pero it doesn't mean na lahat na mga sasabihin nila, lahat na gusto nila mangyari, kailangan ko na agad susundin at ako'y babaw agad sa kanila o sa mga kasamahan ko.
Senators Juan Miguel Zubiri and Cynthia Villar are said to be eyeing the post. Zubiri refuses to confirm he is seeking the third highest post in the land. But he has this to say.
Nagbuo kami ng bloke. Meron kaming bloke. It's a fairly large bloc who believe in the sanctity of the Senate in terms of traditions and rules, independence, the right of every senator to be able to speak their mind, to be able to air their voice and their vote on particular issues without having to stop their advocacies.
Senate Minority Leader Franklin Drilon is advising Senate newbies to study hard about their job because senators live in what he describes as a fishbowl and can be easily criticized by the public.
Few more weeks and the photos on this gallery will be formally changed in favor of the new Senate composition under the 19th Congress. And there will be a new Senate president as well, who, in order to win, should have 13 votes and above. Sharian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Joining us now for a second hot copy, still on the Bongbong Marcos issue, we have former UP Dean of Law, UP College of Law Dean, Attorney Pacifico Agabin, as we continue to talk about the petition against presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos. Good morning, Dean Agabin. Thank you for joining us on Head Start. Dean, you're still on mute. If you can please kindly unmute.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dean. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. So, Dean, I want to ask you first, that resolution coming from the Supreme Court ordering the respondents, COMELEC, Bongbong Marcos, the Senate and the House to comment within 15 days on the petitions as well as the prayer for TRO to stop the canvassing and the proclamation. It was unexpected because they were supposedly on a break, on a recess. What do you make of that development?
Yes, well, usually that resolution of the Supreme Court requires the respondents to comment, Mike, because it is in the interest of fairness and due process. Because the Supreme Court does not take any positive action until after it has heard the side of both parties. But the resolution ordering the respondents to comment does not mean that it has given due course to the petition.
Mm-hmm.
So, it is only routinary and in all cases that the Supreme Court requires respondents to comment on the petition, emphasizing that it does not give due course to the petition yet.
Mm-hmm. But Dean, the fact that the Supreme Court did not issue a TRO when even the petitioners are saying time is of the essence here, because by next week, Bongbong Marcos might have already been proclaimed as President of the Republic of the Philippines. Is that a victory for Mr. Marcos that the Supreme Court did not issue a TRO?
Yes. Usually, as a matter of practice, Mike, the Supreme Court has adopted a restrictive and restraintist approach to the issuance of TROs, even in other cases.
Mm-hmm.
And more especially in this case, where the will of the people has been expressed in an overwhelming way. So I suppose that in the interest of majoritarian democracy, the Supreme Court will not issue a TRO.
But is that a foreshadowing, though, of how the Supreme Court will eventually rule on the pending petitions filed by petitioners?
That is right. And depending on how it will evaluate the comments of the respondent, then it may or may not give due course to the petition and dismiss the petition outright.
Mm-hmm. And Dean, what do you make of the fact that the respondents were given 15 days? In other cases, they were just given 5 days or 10 days to comment. But in this particular instance, 15 days, is that a bit longer than the usual period given for respondents to comment, considering that the proclamation might already happen next week?
That's correct, Mike, because, well, this is a very highly political and sensitive issue, and there are a number of respondents here, so the Supreme Court has decided to give them 15 days to comment, and that mm-hmm. will also give the Supreme Court a leeway to at least listen to the sentiments of the electorate, mm-hmm. considering the majoritarian principle in a democratic system.
Dean Agabin, the lawyer of Bongbong Marcos, Attorney Estelito Mendoza, we interviewed him earlier. He filed a manifestation yesterday with the Supreme Court, essentially saying the Supreme Court does not have jurisdiction to stop the canvassing of votes and the proclamation of winners in an election. Do you agree with this position taken by Attorney Estelito Mendoza?
I have some doubts about that. Mm-hmm. Simply because the provision of the Constitution is that it is the Supreme Court and bank which is the sole judge of all mm-hmm. elections, returns, and qualifications of candidates for the presidency and the vice presidency. So, I do not quite agree with my professor Mendoza mm-hmm. that the Supreme Court has no jurisdiction to stop the proclamation or to issue any further orders, because I think that under this provision of the Constitution, the Supreme Court would have the jurisdiction to issue such order.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But the argument of Attorney Mendoza is that the provisions of the Constitution, when it comes to when the president takes office and when it comes to when the Senate president opens the election returns during the canvassing, are clear when it comes to timeline. Do you agree that these timelines are mandatory and therefore should be followed? There's no room for any extension or any deviance or let's say, diversion from the actual timings indicated in the Constitution.
Yes, well, I'm not too sure if it's mandatory or merely directory. But regardless, under the expanded definition of judicial power, under Article 8, Section 1 of our Constitution, the expanded power of the Supreme Court gives them the power to determine whether there has been a grave abuse of discretion mm-hmm. amounting to lack of jurisdiction.
Mm-hmm.
So
and
that
where should this
it can issue such order under such power.
Where is this grave abuse of discretion should be found, Dean Agabin? Is it on the part of the COMELEC in dismissing the petitions for cancellation of the COC of Mr. Marcos or the disqualification cases? Or is it on the part of the National Board of Canvassers in proclaiming or canvassing the votes for Mr. Marcos?
Well, I must confess, I have not read the petition, Mike, but I think that a petition for certiorari, like what I have read in the newspapers, is that they must have alleged grave abuse of discretion.
Because, on the part of Comelec.
On the part of the Comelec.
All right.
And that is precisely the sacramental phrase used in this type of cases.
Can we say, Dean, that because the Supreme Court has jurisdiction through its judicial review powers of grave abuse of discretion on the part of Comelec, by extension, can the Supreme Court also then issue all incidental matters, like temporarily stopping the canvassing of votes, which is a direct consequence of what will happen if the petitions were dismissed?
Yes, I believe so, Mike, because, well, the power given to the Supreme Court is expanded. And it has the power, it has been given the power to stop or prohibit any grave abuse of discretion amounting to lack or excess of jurisdiction on the part of any branch or instrumentality of the government. And the Congress is an instrumentality or branch of the government. So it can stop.
Canvassing. Dean, assuming that Mr. Marcos gets proclaimed next week, if no TRO is issued by the Supreme Court, will this change the complexion of the pending cases before the Supreme Court? Is there a need now to file new cases, perhaps an election protest, or a quaranto? Because they're saying if you're an impeachable officer, you can only be removed through quaranto.
Well, I think that this case will be, if this case will be given due course, then I think the Supreme Court can render a decision based on the evidence. But of course, you know very well that proving a grave abuse of discretion is an uphill battle. No? It's like swimming against the current in jurisprudence. So it is only if the evidence is very strong that the Supreme Court will give due course to a petition like this.
And Dean, it goes beyond just having a different appreciation of the facts and the law in the case, right? It's not just about having a different opinion on a particular matter.
I beg your pardon?
When you talk about grave abuse of discretion, Dean, we're not just talking about the Supreme Court having a difference in opinion with the Comelec in terms of appreciating the facts and the law. It requires something more than that. Is that right, Dean?
Yes, well, in a case like this, the evidence has to be strong. As I said, the definition of grave abuse of discretion is such that there must be gross and willful and capricious decision made by the Comelec.
Are you seeing any of that in the way the Comelec decided the cases before it against Bongbong Marcos? Are you seeing any hint of grave abuse of discretion?
Well, there has been instances of grave abuse of discretion in other political cases. And the Supreme Court has given due course to such cases. But of course, the evidence was quite strong. So the Supreme Court disqualified the candidate in question.
Now, Dean,
in this case, as I said, only the local government executives.
Now, Dean, can the petitioners say COMELEC took its time deciding on the cases? It left us without any remedy to go to the Supreme Court before the elections happened. They essentially released, effectively, they released the decision a day after the elections. Can the petitioners say we have been deprived of our remedies before the Supreme Court because the COMELEC acted with grave abuse of discretion? Is that an argument they could make?
Yes. The argument would be that the candidate involved is really disqualified based on certain facts as well as on the law on elections and probably on violations of the Internal Revenue Code.
Now, Dean,
as I said, this is an uphill battle insofar as the petitioners are concerned.
Dean, very quickly, and lastly, we don't have much time, but what happens now? Assuming that there's a proclamation of Bongbong Marcos as president, if ever he gets disqualified or his COC gets canceled, who will succeed him? Who will replace him? Is it the vice president? Is it the second placer?
Well, if there are two petitions actually filed here, if the first petition, which is for cancellation of the COC of Bongbong Marcos, succeeds, then this second highest, the highest number of valid votes, namely that of Lady Robredo, will be considered, and that of Bongbong Marcos would be considered stray votes. However, the second petition, which is a combination of the first as well as on disqualification based on violation of the Internal Revenue Code, if Bongbong Marcos is disqualified, then the Vice President, Sara Duterte, will have to take over the position.
Notwithstanding the Makiling case, sir, 2013 Makiling case, where disqualification case resulted in actually the second placer, the vice, the second placer taking office as mayor.
What is this case?
2013 Makiling versus COMELEC case, sir, decided and by ousted Chief Justice Maria Lourdes Sereno. They're citing that, the petitioners.
Yes, I'm not quite aware of that petition, of that decision. But in that case, I suppose that it is the Vice President Lenny Robredo would be the one to proclaim the president.
All right. On that note, we don't have much time. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, former UP College Law Dean Pacifico Agabin.
Yeah. Salamat din, Mike.
And that's Head Start today. I'm Mike Navalio. Thank you for watching. Stay informed. Stay with ANC.